get accumulation with this?
Okay.
Scatter chart.
We're supposed to be a little interested.
I mean, I'm...
I missed our whole conversation about gaming the system. How to make your stack higher without actually doing anything.
Put it on my cat's tail.
Give it to yourself.
Welcome, everybody. It is our goal to keep this within the hour, to the best of our ability. So welcome. This is the second meeting of the joint town council and school board's finance committee meeting, or it's really more of a workshop environment that we work within. And so I want to welcome everyone. And today, like every day, I'll help facilitate on behalf of the council, and then I'm also working with Jody Shea from the school board. And our members, we do have a few members that are not available today because they're out of town or are busy, and that was Peter Hayes and Christine Messengill had other duties, and Carrie Lightford should be on her way. But we do have present with us Chris Chiazzo from the town council's finance committee, George Entwistle, the superintendent of our schools, Tom Hall, the manager, Ruth Porter, finance director for the town, and Kate Bolton, the director of finance for the schools, as well as myself. And then we do have Bill Donovan, who is chair of the town council, as a guest, and will be participating as well. With that, I think the next order of business is that we're going to move on to old business, which is an update regarding CPAIR, and I'm going to turn that over to Tom and George.
Yeah, I think George, I know George, you had an update today.
Yes, we had another meeting to really put the final touches on the scope for the research that CPAIR, which is no longer called CPAIR anymore, it's now the Maine Education Policy Research Institute at USM, but we put some finishing touches on the scope of the work that they're going to be doing. The purpose of that work will basically be, they will be using what they call relevant and publicly available aggregate data to evaluate the efficiency of how the Scarborough School Department and I guess it's really focused on just the school department, is using its financial resources, and that would be by way of comparing school funding and educational outcomes data for Scarborough and a select set of peers, or what we call cohort. Kate and I sat with them today, with the researchers, and basically worked through looking at the matching of cohorts. They feel that they should be doing it on the basis of equal weight given to a free and reduced lunch percentage, a enrollment match in terms of how close it's matched, the other districts are matched in enrollment to Scarborough, and also something that we've not really looked at, which is valuation per student. We had a good and pretty productive conversation. It's really interesting to see some of the graphics that they did on a preliminary basis, just in terms of looking and matching on those three. So I think it would be a very credible cohort that they'll come up with. Basically, they'll be looking probably since 2010, 2011, and looking at and comparing the data in terms of spending and outcomes. The most recent year that they will have is going to be 2013-14, and we will be able to probably extrapolate and pull in 14-15 and go from there. Anyway, so they will be preparing a report for us, and the one presentation that they'll do is to this group, and that will be on March 24th, which is the regularly scheduled meeting of this group. So the Policy Institute will come and basically give their report out to this group. They'll be in touch with us as they need clarification on any data or things that they're seeing, but they're basically resourcing all of that themselves and doing the analysis. I think it's interesting that the kinds of things that they're going to be looking at would be as in terms of the comparison with the cohorts is around student performance data, which is, there's a lot of the proficiency percentages that are available and can be matched and contrasted. On the expenditure side, operating expenditure per pupil, expenditure per pupil by category, looking at regular instruction, special ed, admin, debt service, et cetera. And they're also going to be looking at teacher-student ratio. So they're really, they've got some good metrics, and some of these match the metrics that were identified by the school board, things that they want to be looking at. In terms of student and district needs, they'd be taking a look at Scarborough's and other districts' EPS allocation, and of course the labor market, given the fact that so much of our expenditure is related to personnel and benefits, the labor market area salary indexes are very important as well. Around subsidy, of course you've all heard the not so good early projection on a loss of about $1.6 million in terms of subsidy, but really looking at subsidy as a percentage of allocation, looking at the trends in terms of the change in valuation, and Kate and I have presented some of that in past years as that's evolved, and also in terms of enrollment. And just around enrollment, I've had some other data collected through Phil Kallick, who is kind of our data master, if you will, for the schools, and I'm looking at some of those trends. I'm going to be taking some time over vacation to kind of step away and just spend some time in looking at what that data is telling us. The last piece is what they call tax efforts for education, looking at an equalized tax rate for education, looking at expenditure as a percentage of EPS allocation, and also doing some consideration and analysis with median household income. So they really, they look to be pulling together a very comprehensive analysis that should be very helpful, both in terms of looking and helping us get ready to look at those metrics, maybe even considering some additional metrics that they have had access to, and again, answering that question about the efficiency of the way things are being run right now. So the delivery to us, we had established a mid-March delivery date. They will probably meet with us one last time mid-March and just get all of their ducks in a row, and then be prepared for the presentation on the 24th. So I think it's going to be very interesting. That's where we are. Anything that you want to add?
I would just add that the end product, along with the report out to this group, is a published report that will be hopefully high level enough to be easily accessible by the public and something that we can post and draw from as we go forward. And you know, goes to the problem of the credibility of the data that we're able to produce in-house, and I think kind of solves that in a way by bringing in some outside experts who really know their stuff, and this is kind of their job, it's their day job, so I think it's very cool. It's been neat listening to them talk.
Yeah, it is. It has been, and it's been very insightful, and it just kind of rattled through this stuff. This is really... this group has really evolved from the David Silvernail group that has done a lot of work, and most of the work that this group does now is to inform the legislature.
They're like legislative analysts on a lot of the stuff that comes before the legislature.
So the goal of the report, I assume, is twofold. One, to establish a credible cohort for comparison, and two, to look at some data points for evaluating performance.
The cohort is really is provides the contrast and analysis, but they are, you know, sort of from a research perspective, creating that cohort matched on those three items that I spoke about, and then the next level of contrast and comparison is really in terms of the expenditures and the performance piece in terms of, you know, it's basically a return on investment.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's what I would call the analysis.
just had a question, George. The one meeting I sat in the initial meeting with them, and it's something that we tried to get to this time last year, which was kind of setting expectations around level services. There was a lot of conversation from the podium that we should be striving to a CPI number, for instance. And our sense was that didn't make sense given the nature of your organization. Are they doing anything around that in terms of helping us and everyone else understand what is a reasonable amount of growth? Just to, before you do any new investment, what do you expect this year to year?
Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that they can speak to that pretty much off the cuff because they have a good sense of what CPI is and what it's intended for and what it's not intended for. I think that there was also part of this was going to be some level of research that they would go back and take a look at that question. I don't know how deeply they're going to jump into it. I think a cursory sort of review that they did kind of, you know, found the same thing that you and I found as we dug into it, which there's really not, there's just not a lot that's written about it.
I guess I'd be interested in the group. To me, that's a really important part of the conversation because if we can, as a community, understand what reasonably expect what happens in an institution like a school system, we can then focus our conversation around the investments as opposed to fighting about what's reasonable. You know, what's doing. What's the percent gain that we should expect if we do nothing new and different?
Well, I'm hoping that the cohort comparison is going to be able to show us that information as well, because if you look at, you know, the whole challenge for a cohort comparison was, is it really apples to apples? And instead of discussing what's apples to apples, the discussion really needs to be, is the investment appropriate for the outcomes that we're seeking? So I think my hope out of coming out of a report like this would be we have a third-party group coming in, evaluating multiple districts across the state, looking at some parameters, if you will. If we can agree to those parameters and decide that that's how we want to measure our success as well, we can use that report as a template and as a benchmark moving forward and say, okay, then where are our goals based on that report of how we're comparing to the other cohorts that they've established, not just us. Where are they? Do we want to be there with them? Are we better than them in some areas? If we are, let's work on that. If you know, let's push that forward as positive. And if there's areas of improvement, certainly we could maybe use them as a benchmark and say, okay, if we're here and they're someplace else, do we want to get to where they are, and how long does it want to take to get there?
Yeah, it was just the expenditure conversation, as I heard it, had everything to do with kind of those per pupil statistics. And I know that to be the best data that's available, so I'm not surprised you're looking at that. I guess my thought is more spending in the aggregate, almost not just understanding the nature of an educational institution with 75% of your costs being
personnel.
Just by that very nature suggests that they don't act like consumers, for instance. There's all sorts of strange factors that will make that organization's costs go up disproportionate to other indexes. And it'd be great if there was a published index that we could look to. We did some research and couldn't find one last year.
I think the difficulty with the data that they're looking at and the per pupil expenditures is that they don't know how much of that is status quo for a given district and how much of it is new investment. All they know is what was spent. But we may be able, by putting all the pieces together, what the state thinks your appropriate EPS allocation is, plus what most districts spend over and above that to provide a good education, we may be able to come at it and back into what level services looks like.
And they will, you know, to the extent that, you know, 3 years makes a trend, they will be able to give us a sense of the kind of year-over-year changes that are happening in other places. You know, you're basically looking at those cohorts and then what's happening here. I may just have a little quick conversation to follow up and see what they think, but I believe they talked about doing some research, but that was really sort of a very secondary piece because they pretty much were saying that they didn't believe that they were really going to find anything that would be helpful to us, and that the more relevant data and the more credible data is what is relevant and readily available as, from the public data stores, if you will.
Yeah, I mean, the single statistic of ROI, if it could be boiled down to that level of specificity, would do great wonders.
Yeah, I think that that's, you know, in essence, I mean, that's what this study really is, and I think that, that they will have all of the components of an ROI. I think they've kind of enjoyed jumping in and taking a look at this. So.
Good. Yeah, and I know we don't have an endless budget or much time. So it's important to get this launched and be a backdrop before we make presentation, before the different groups get immersed in budget review.
Well, and I think they also appreciate the fact that if this is going to be helpful in terms of, you know, increasing or enhancing public education, public understanding of education, the community's understanding of education, it's got to be pretty straightforward, and it's got to make sense. So, and I believe that they have that as their framework going forward. So I think it's. I have tremendous confidence that this is going to be a good product.
I think it's important to keep in mind, so one, as I do, there was a reference made, because we are being taped and who knows who, you know, watched this. The intent was originally set out to find data that supported both an evaluation of schools and municipalities. There's more relevant data to be able to do an evaluation around schools and educational funding. There's very little, if any, around municipal, so that's why there's the focus on education. I don't want people to believe that we're solely focusing on education because there's a concern there. It was really was there trying to be a balanced conversation around that. And as far as the data and the presentation, this is a great exercise because it gets us one step closer to where we need to finally be, which is to talk about where do we want the community to be. Mm-hmm. No consultant, no institute, no consultant is going to sit there and tell us, you know what, you're underfunding your community by 4%, 5%, 10%, whatever that might be. That's what we're here to interpret as part of what, you know, that history that they're going to give us. I mean, they're going to give us a snapshot of where we are today in comparison. And you're going to get people who, right out of the box, are going to sit there and say, I don't like the schools or I don't like the districts that we're selecting to be in our cohort. There's going to be those that are just going to happen. Then there's going to be some that say, I don't like the metrics because it doesn't really tell you the real issue, you know, whatever it might be. So no matter what, we're going to come up to a challenge. I think it's about whether or not this group of elected officials, as well as going forward, as well as staff, are comfortable with those metrics so that we can start getting to that substantive conversation.
Mm-hmm.
Because some of us are getting tired of just, you know, rebuilding the footsteps to get to where we need to
right.
be. And so I'm excited about getting to that point and getting that information. I did want to ask around the presentation, is the presentation going to be in this type of style and format? Are we going to open that up to others that might be interested? Because this could be pretty valuable to maybe invite other school board members. We'll invite, of course, the rest of the council. You know, how do we want to have that presentation? And do we want to have it as a communal dialogue, or do we want it just to be a working group of the six members of the committee, the joint committee, and staff? I mean, we should kind of.
I think they're. I think
that before we walk into it.
They're not interested in doing sort of public presentations.
Okay.
By virtue of the being videotaped, this will be that will be the public presentation for them. I would think that Jody would want to invite the other board members and that you would want to invite the other council
yeah.
members. But that's really how the meeting has been characterized.
Okay.
Recognizing that
sure.
this thing can be replayed or the presentation can be, you know, sort of extracted from the
okay.
from the meeting part of it and used. But that's how they spend their time. They like to spend their time doing calculations and statistical analysis.
There will be
a physical report. Yeah.
George, I know that the. Some of the people in the last year were concerned about how we came up with our cohort group.
Mm-hmm.
Are they going to be picking that cohort group so it won't
yeah,
seem
yeah.
biased on the you know?
Yeah, that's
side.
That was one of their charges was to use the data and find what would be the most relevant cohort group. I think that they'll be able to do that in terms of the factors that I shared with you in terms of free and reduced lunch and evaluation per pupil and so on. They will also, so they would be able to create that. Of course, they're looking in Cumberland and New York County, which is really the labor market that we draw from. But they would also be able to, from a larger cohort group, really look at a group that is more sort of our aspirational cohort group. And so you can sort of, I think, you know, I'm imagining, and they seem to be agreeing that this could be done, that we can look at a sort of a larger cohort group and then sort of zoom in and take a look at a group that is more the preferred student outcome group that we wish to be a part of. But I think that it will be broader based to begin with.
I think they were looking at close to 20 different districts, and some of them, you know, we did go back and forth with some of the folks in the public last year about, well, are we only cherry picking the groups that we want to be compared with because we like the way their student outcomes are happening? Of course, they're spending more money, but we should be comparing ourselves with other districts. I think this is going to be bigger, and it's going to be more scientific in its selection, so that they really are comparable to us on those factors, and that should hopefully make folks feel a little happier about that.
And I think having the different factors helps play into that. You know, we're looking at free and reduced lunch, we're looking at population, we're looking at student enrollment. All of those things are going to flush out and bring to the top the people that we need to compare ourselves with, whether we like it or not, you know, but I think it's good that there's somebody outside of us doing that.
The aspirational aspect of the cohort is probably the policy conversation. These are the ones we want to get to, and
right.
How do we get there?
Right.
And what are they doing, and how are we going to get there?
So you take a big data set, and you say, well, here's the student outcomes coming out of this level of spending, and, you know, not that it's a one-to-one correlation,
mm-hmm.
but let's take a look at the folks that we'd like to be.
And what is it going to take to get there?
Right.
Which provides more relevant and more local data to what you were asking in your question.
Which is what is an appropriate growth model.
And speaking to Sean's point, that this is really, using that data, it's really this group that should be charting that progression or that, you know, that advancement.
I was glad to hear you say that they're looking at per capita income. I know that frustrates me in terms of the state education funding formula, the lack of consideration of per capita income, because I think that reflects a lot of the kind of feedback you get from a community as to what they feel they can and cannot absorb for taxes and school costs. So I think that's, it also is a nice measure to say how are we doing versus other communities with comparable per capita incomes, because that really tells you, so I think in many ways a better measure of wealth of a community than the assessed value of the property.
Cool. So it's not too far away, and it's pretty short amount of time when we'll have some good information to take a look at.
Good. And certainly to the extent that they're indicating that this was done independently, then it should be stated very clearly that this, you know, this is not a guided
right. It's their
initiative.
It's their analysis.
Their analysis.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks a lot. Anything else? Hi, Carrie.
Hi.
No, not at all. And moving on to new business. First item is to identify. By the way, the goal here, I believe, is that this is kind of a ordering of everything that we put forward at the last meeting. So the first two items that we have are identifying relevant metrics for the school and the town. You know, personally, I'll start. I think I personally would rather wait and see the CPAIR, or no, it's now ME,
METRI,
whatever the new acronym is. We'd like to see that report before at least talking about the schools. You know, someone was talking to me the other day, and I 100% agree with them. I think it's important for everyone to understand what the metrics are and how they're defined, but I think it's up to the school board and the school board members to determine which metrics that they're most comfortable with in directing the school department. I mean, that's what, you know, that's what they're here for.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, not that I don't want to be part of the conversation, because I think it's important that the counselors understand the importance of them, because it goes into the budgeting process, because then it hopefully leads to prioritization of funding on your end, even though we don't really do, you know, allocations. So I hope that as we communicate these metrics out, that we're pretty clear on how they're defined, which ones they are, how they're defined, and then who's really responsible for identifying the appropriate ones for their respective group. And I think that based on what I'm hearing, it's going to be a hard conversation for the town council to decide which ones that they want on the town side, because there is so little. It's going to come down to preference rather than research.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I think for the school side, we as a group have talked about it for a number of weeks about metrics that we feel are important. But I agree in that once we see this report, we'll have a better idea of if we're on track with with those ideas that we have. And I think we even discussed it here briefly last time. You know, per pupil spending, it seems like an obvious one, I think, for all of us. And the other one that stands out for me, and, you know, maybe I'll be proved wrong with this report, but is student-teacher ratio. I think that is very simple on the surface, but when you sort of dig into those numbers, it talks a lot about investment in education for a town. It talks about investment in staff and how we allocate students among those staff. So I think those two for us were the top two that sort of came to the top. But it sounds like there may be some more once we get this report.
And for me, I think that there's two levels of metrics. One is there's the global or enterprise metrics that can be used for the entire community. And then there might be some individualized metrics that are within the data set that they're going to give us that can help identify whether or not you're achieving the bigger goal.
Right.
I mean, in business, when we were in banking, they always had, this is your, you know, the company's goal overall, and then you had your individual department, and it all kind of had to flow into that. And I think what we need to do, though, is that once those are determined, and we started it last year, is that we need to take those metrics, and then we need to quantify and say, as part of the budget request, here is your dollar breakdown on how it's going to support that individual metrics, and here is our expected outcome, or here is an estimate of that expected outcome, whether it's a 1% increase, a, you know, half a percent, whatever it might be. That way it shows that we're kind of achieving what we're expecting, or at least hoping to achieve.
I just think one of the pieces of the conversation that can't sort of be dropped and sort of explained to, by way of saying there's no relevant and available data on the town side, is that a commitment to establish metrics that do make sense and that do really demonstrate some level of efficiency. It's going to be a tougher job. The data here is going to get pretty deep, and it's going to be a pretty good analysis. I think that you know, I'm excited to do that on the school side, but it does seem as though just the lack of relevant data or available data doesn't mean to say then that the whole focus should be on the school.
Oh, I totally agree with that.
I hope at the end of this process, honestly, what ends up happening is we have a more objective way of approaching the investment in education, and that we can take some of the, or most of the subjectivity out of the discussions that we're having, because that's where we seem to be focusing a lot of our attention. What's appropriate level services? That's a subjective measure at this point, because we have nothing to compare it to. So if we can come out of this process as a town with a clearly defined, or as clearly defined as possible, objective analysis of where we are and where we'd like to be, that makes the investment discussion that much easier, because we can say we have a goal here. So now we have a clear plan for the school department. To me, it would behoove the municipal side departments as well to adopt a similar process or program if they can, because quite frankly, if it comes on objectivity versus subjectivity, you can justify objectivity a lot easier, I think, in the public's eye than you can subjectivity. So if there's a process that we can come out of this, maybe this is a great model, and we go to the Maine Municipal Association at the end and say, hey, why don't you start collecting some data from your associate members, and, you know, kind of either on the side or unofficial or informal, or come up with a policy. There's clearly a need for that. I can't imagine we're the only town in the state that's trying to see where our spending is and where it's supposed to be in an objective manner.
Well, the only alternative is to have somebody sit at a phone and call every community in the neighborhood and say, well, what do you spend on public safety?
It's not that easy, and I'm not trying to be argumentative, but I can tell you from having done a benchmark study with 6 or 7, communities in Greater Portland, whom we're very close and friendly with, great relations with, the differences between their municipal operation and ours are vast. And it's not a phone call. It is literally, extended conversations around understanding what is public works and how it is public
do
works
for
here.
You?
There
what
are,
services
it's
do
just
they
a different setup. And so, getting to that point, it would be great to have equalized data that we could have confidence in, apples-to-apples comparisons.
Mm-hmm.
To get there, there's no mechanism that I'm aware of. The data doesn't exist. It needs to be mined. It needs to be massaged to the point that we're all comfortable with it.
Is there anything that comes out of SECO, or is that strictly Scarborough?
Yeah, Scarborough specific. You know, I have raised the question with Cumberland County. Alex Kimball is their finance director, and quite capable in his own right, and they sit at a obviously regional level. They would have, it's easy for me to say that someone else has time, but it would be a tremendous service, as you alluded to. I think it would be a great value to everyone.
Yeah.
Just through fits and starts, we haven't been able to do this and do it consistently and do it well.
If there's a way of looking at it percentage wise, does that help sort of level the playing field? Meaning, does Falmouth spend 12% of their budget on public works? Does Cumberland spend 15%? Like, if you start to look at it as a percentage-wise, does that help
I think that's a fallback. That's a fallback for lack of anything else in place. I mean, that's like us picking picking a cohort just kind of arbitrarily based on either geography or, another arbitrary factor. And I mean, I'm sure we could find relative towns and relative comparisons, but then, of course, we're in the same situation on the municipal side that we are on the school side, with somebody is going to question it, always,
mm-hmm.
and where did you come up with that number, why are you picking them? I don't expect us to be able to conclude a process like this in a year or even two. I think this is a long, systemic, process. And if we can get resources from Cumberland County or Maine Municipal Association, some group that has a farther reaching capacity and resources perhaps than we do, I mean, I think that might be part of the advocacy piece is to say, look, this is what we're trying to do here. We think there's benefit to this in Cumberland County. There's certainly benefit to this in, Maine Municipal Association. Why don't you work with us and come up with this same discussion on municipal level? What metrics do you look at? How do you what types of public works
the
are there?
The difference between schools and towns is that and you might not like it, but DOE and the feds mandate, there's a lot of similarities. All districts have to do a lot of the same stuff.
They all have the same chart of accounts. Which is insane,
right, so there's that equalization out of the gate.
Yep.
Yeah.
How do you compare a full-service community like Scarborough and Buxton next door to us? That's not a fair comparison. You look at any per capita statistic or overall spending, they're just not comparable.
So you really have to dive into the services provided.
You do. It's a project.
Yep. It is for sure.
I guess my point in bringing it up is, just by nature of the way things happen to get a school budget, there's a lot of focus on us. This is going to another whole level of an independent focus and review, and I think that's great. I'm not interested in digging into the town's business. I just don't want us any more myopically focused on the schools, because we get pretty entrenched in some pretty tiny, fairly insignificant, not relevant conversations that really, basically it's a disservice to the students who have their leaders and their teacher is distracted for such a protracted period of time, you know, while we, you know, look to see how many pencils we're buying, or, I mean, not that it's gotten quite that bad, but I would not be surprised to be asked that question. I think what we, that what this group should do is at least commit to keeping a balance there, just because this is sort of relevant and publicly available. As Chris said, this may create a model that allows us to think about, or you all to think about, how, what data there is available publicly, relevant public data that is available, that would at least begin to do the same kind of modeling as what this analysis will do. So it's really, it's not like pay more attention over there. It's really, like, I'm hoping that this is not going to be a budget cycle of sort of deeper conversations into sort of irrelevance.
I think it's important to remember why we started this process. I mean, there was a big, there's always been a big question in the community about trust. And I think by opening this process up, having meetings like this, exploring this process with third-party people, the point is that we are trying to establish that trust, that it's not just six people sitting in a room and coming up with arbitrary ideas of what we think is the best thing to do because that's the way we feel about it. So I think ultimately, I don't think we're going to achieve everything all at once. I mean, to your point, right now this is where we put the focus on. I think if we can develop a certain amount of trust through this process, then I'm hoping the attention will shift off of the discussions of, well, what exactly is level services? You know, you would say, I don't know, school department, what do you consider level services? Or when we have this discussion in future budget cycles, are we going to establish level services as service or funding? Or we could have that discussion, at least from a common perspective. I think we're always going to have critics and challenges no matter what, but a report like this, I think the important thing is to come out of this group saying, okay, we know who these people are, they're credible, we don't even know what their results are yet. We may not like everything that comes out of it, but at least we've taken that extra time, that extra step to have a third party come in. This is their opinion. They're a trusted source. They're not a private company that we've hired. They're reputable. And what comes out of that, that's what we'll start to base policy on, or at least have those policy discussions around. And I think that's making informed decisions, and that's, I think, what people expect us to do. They may not like our decisions, but they expect us to make informed decisions.
Yeah, I mean, what do you say after that? I mean, I agree. I personally, I did not enter into this process 2 years ago now, or a year and a half, because I believe that there was distrust and that we had to somehow create the level of trust. At the core of it, it's not trust. That's the issue. It's the disagreement and what we're making, the decisions that we're making, and then they throw out a sensitive word saying, well, but I don't trust you. No, you disagree with the decisions that are being made. It's not an issue of trust. And then we get marred by creating these processes in order to kind of build that back up. And I'm okay with doing that because as long as we don't have to recreate it in another couple of years, fine, I can accept that part of it. But I agree with George. This is about a balanced conversation in this community because for too long we've had the municipal budget and we've had the school budget. It's really one budget. And it's always been this competitive fight around that, and it's about a disagreement on where money is being spent, and which is no different than disagreements in your own household, maybe, or disagreements at the different levels of government. It's always going to happen. Because think about this, if we create the best process at the end of this, what's going to happen is not going to be anything left to not disagree about, right? Except for the decisions that are being made, and then someone's still going to say, I don't trust the decisions that, you know, so... I'm looking for the same balance, I think, George, because then we'll get to the substantive conversation. And by the way, on the municipal side, I think it's a very different dog in the show when you talk about municipal ratios and municipal trends. And I agree we need to have them, and we will come up with them. I don't believe you need to have the resources to support what you can select as a metrics. And the reason is that I think that the normal person doesn't sit there and say, well, I live in Scarborough because it's better than South Portland. They will say, I live in Scarborough because the school system is better than South Portland, but not because the police department is not somehow better, or the roads are being plowed better, or these other services. And it's because in the end, you can't really determine whether or not which town is really doing a better job anyways. So I'm happy with not doing research and looking at what are the trends over the last 5 years in the ratios, just in our own community, and how can we improve it. And some of that might be, you know, internal numbers, you know, response time for, you know, EMS or fire department or police or, you know, whatever those metrics might be. It's more of an internal kind of analysis rather than going outwards to other communities, where schools is about comparing to other communities. It's just weird about that.
Yeah, in other words, looking at the citizen satisfaction, what's important,
well,
how do the residents view it,
that
they want.
It draws the question that in the end, should we, in order to determine whether or not we're achieving our goal, should we be having an annual satisfaction survey? I mean, corporations do it. They'll have a customer satisfaction survey to determine are you delivering your services, and then there's an employee satisfaction to determine are you happy in doing it.
You know, I agree that I think that's a great idea. In that, most of the time, quiet people are satisfied.
Yep.
And so, you know, we spend a lot of time talking about the louder or the more vocal parts, the outliers. But there's a large section of this town, you know, that did move here because they get trash and recycling picked up at their driveway, or the schools are better. Or so there's a large majority that are satisfied. And so I think for Tom's knowledge, or for all of our knowledge, it's just nice to sort of get that back.
Well, and then as leaders, you don't find yourself being influenced quite so strongly by the squeaky wheel.
You're not guessing.
You're really getting a broader view of what your community's looking for.
Mm-hmm.
Because none of us can help being influenced by, you know, getting 15 emails from an angry person and never hearing from the person who really actually likes what we're doing. Human nature.
Expressed from the conversation, the town metrics are going to be much harder to put together. Certainly not done by March 24th. That's part of this time for this discussion. But I think it is certainly something we need to be focused on and work towards. My expectation when it comes to the school, and I appreciate the light is being shined on the school, but my expectation is that the light's going to turn away from the school, because the results from this are going to tell a much different story. And that's really what I want to do, is to rise above whether it's lack of trust or poking holes in the data or whatever the case is, and really get to the meat of the conversations.
Right.
Where are we going? And how are we going to get there? And what's it going to cost?
Right.
It's not about tearing down things.
Right. If we're not doing it wrong, then maybe we ought to talk about how we're going to do
right.
it right.
Mm-hmm. Better.
Yeah, better.
Right. Anything else?
Okay.
So this is going to be an ongoing item for us, right?
I think so.
Okay.
Just a final piece on that. Ruth has committed to finalizing the benchmark data on those 7 or 8 communities for its 2013 data, the most best we have. We have it all in-house. She's just putting the final touches on it and the graphic displays and whatnot. So that will be available sooner than later. It is a bit dated. And I think it does serve as a platform that we can build from. And Sean, you could be helpful. Maybe we could arrange a meeting with Peter Creighton and Neil Jameson and Alex Kimball and see if this is a project that we take over and do it year in and year out. Because I think there is great value across the county.
Great.
Even if it just starts, and you know, it's something that builds on every year. You know, it's not going to be perfect right out of the gate, but can get it down and then at least start building from there. All right.
Globally, to get to your point, I mean, Cumberland County could be a service provider for consulting services around that.
They could host this. I mean, there's any number of regional entities that could take this. Next item is,
Nobody did their homework.
We all said we want to use. I had that feeling, so I said, no, I'm just ready to know what I got.
I shouldn't say nobody. Carrie sent me a couple, and Peter also sent me a few. So this, I believe, will also be an ongoing project
So what I asked at our last meeting was that everyone should send me terms that they would like to see put on the website, made more public, just to help in understanding things that we're talking about. I mean, in the school department, we hear it all the time that we're always using acronyms, and it helps to sort of step back and think, okay, how, you know, does the general public understand what we're saying? So we've started a list. It's a very short list, I have to say.
I have one to add.
Perfect. So if you have one or two or three that you would like to add, let me know. You can write them on your sheets and then hand them back in, and I will I'll distribute the whole list, and we can sort of divide and conquer and add our own definitions and come together and actually finalize the definitions we all feel comfortable moving forward with. But yes, there should be more to this list. Fair enough?
Henry, works.
I have one addition, but it has many subsets. Whatever metric, well, it's any metric that is identified needs to be defined.
Yes. Good
how
point.
It's calculated and what it means.
Right.
Yep.
Has to, it really needs to be.
Great point. Yep. Okay. You still have homework to be continued.
Yep. I did it on.
So just so you keep him, because we do have the. It is being taped, but for the public, so far the glossary, the purpose of the glossary of terms is to help communicate the presentations that we have as well as the information. And so someone mentioned that we should create this kind of glossary. And so far we have essential services, you know, what is it, what are budget cuts, and how is that defined, what are level services, what is zero-based budgeting, what are controllable versus uncontrollable expenditures, operational versus capital expenditures, EPS, which is, I believe, earnings, not earnings.
Essential program and services.
Evaluation, and then the additions that we're all kind of talking about.
Does it make sense to throw them out now, or are you?
Oh, yeah, sure. If you guys want to throw them out, I'll take them. Metrics?
We've got two kinds of evaluation, too, because EPS rests on the state revenue services folks, and then we have our local valuation.
But I thought, having further discussions, I thought Augusta takes our valuation and uses it. They don't do an independent one. They evaluate our process, I guess, for lack of a better word. And if they're comfortable with it, they take what the town's valuation is and put that in.
Yeah.
They don't have independent auditors running around, right?
I heard that they do have people.
Maine Revenue does have, they're not separate auditors, but they're Maine Revenue Service employees that come in and do checks of the quality and ratios of assessments. And when there are disparities, what they use is something, it's a factored up, they call it the state equalized value. So a community that has values at, let's say, 80% of market, and some do, some are as low as 70%, frankly. That's not fair, obviously. There's 30% of value that's not being reported. That could incredibly skew
right.
the EPS formula, or the distribution formula. So the state will factor that up to 100%. So the number they use is the state equalized valuation. It's not necessarily the number that each community reports.
That needs to be
defined.
Yeah, they're a couple
yeah,
of years
fine.
Behind, too, I think. Okay.
I have a few.
Great.
I'll just give them to you, but I'll read them. Per pupil spending, subsidy, free and reduced lunch, student-teacher ratio, enrollment. Even enrollment, people wonder why the numbers are not don't always match. And there's a specific way that we define enrollment, because we just have a number in October and a number in April. That's the enrollment piece. But every day, pretty much every day, we know how many kids are enrolled. But we have kids coming and going basically all the time.
Thank you.
I'm not sure what they would be, but there would be some terms, I would think, around special education services requirements, things that are mandated by the state that aren't necessarily
like
funded.
That would be
great
mm-hmm.
to include.
Mm-hmm.
504, for instance, mandated, unfunded.
Mm-hmm.
had some students, I'll hand you the sheet too. I had unfunded mandates, which is what Carrie had said, special education, what the, by definition, what that is. What it, what's, I mean, I know it's kind of a catch-all, but it's a big, tends to be a big ticket item.
Mm-hmm.
Restricted fund balance versus unrestricted fund balance. Shared services, what we mean by that. With school debt service versus town debt service, and then total debt service. And just a discussion or a breakdown of how that.
Have a whole
dictionary, by the
way. I know.
I don't know if you believe in this, but a Google document that we could all
get
in.
That's great. Yeah.
So if you loaded it and then shared it with us, I think
we're not on Google.
We don't.
Sorry, town's not on Google. We're
yet.
We're 20th century.
So we'll define these things. We'll define them all.
Email account.
Those on Google,
which
one? Those on Google will rule the world.
Yeah.
But I mean, it would be easy that way, and I could share it with a few other people and ask them to put in their, like,
you could
definition.
Simple Word doc. Why can't you just share it?
Well, I was just going to say you could take it a Word doc and email it.
Word doc. Okay.
At least
we didn't
have
to
make any Times Roman
typewriter. He hasn't migrated up.
is it worthwhile?
The truth is, you guys were kicking and screaming the whole way. Now you're there and you're happy.
Regarding, like, I hate to say CPI, but consumer price index, or what you use to determine, like, wage increases, what we use for wage increases, COLA.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't something that determine. You know.
And then we could probably. And just add some categories so that we don't have all this just mushed in together.
I mean, if we really want to get into the weeds too, you can start talking about what is a collective bargained agreement. What does that mean? What is, because I mean, there's issues.
But I think we need to keep in mind that it needs to be relevant to the communications that we're giving. So
right.
I mean, it's all good information, but unless we're talking about collective bargaining agreements in our presentations and our financials, it's not really to me. I think though we need to, if we're going to use again, metrics, I cover it. CPI is going to be one of the metrics, then we need to define it. If it's not, then I don't personally needs to be included.
Well, whatever it is, we need to define whatever we
there
need.
Are, I think, a total of 11 different CPI measures.
Oh, yeah, that's
so, I mean, yeah, we're opening up another big can of worms. So I think that, you know, what I do, and I promise to do this, is that I want to make sure that the terms are also balanced so that right now there's a lot of that are related to the school's budget. And not those that under the critics, because there are a lot of criticisms even on the town budget. So we should think about
some. Any of those.
I know, huh?
You're not on Google.
Because you're not on Google.
I thought we were on Google.
We're
not on Google. It was Google Mail. I keep getting everybody's email attached to it. I mean, whatever. But I'll do a better job for the next meeting and make sure that we get some that balances. Because as an example, I put investments on mine. There's two definitions. There's investments on the town side, which is totally different than when you talk about investment in education.
Right.
Investment in education is an IRA account or a money market account. It's a project. So
I
envision actually using this glossary and maybe expanding it as part of the budget document. Why
right,
not?
Right,
yeah.
Right, right. It becomes an appendix or whatever.
So we have,
and we did start labeling.
Yeah, I know.
I just had a couple more, Jody, or where you going, Sean?
No, I have mine in.
Just educational outcomes. I'm not sure what that means.
Educational outcomes.
Outcomes. Yeah. What are the measures that are relevant to use? Cohort came up earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Just a simple definition. And I said discretionary spending. That might be helpful. And that goes hand in hand with a mandate.
Well, it goes with the mandate, and it also kind of goes with the collective bargaining point that Chris is making, is that if you have something that's codified in a contract that you don't have discretion over in that sense. Okay. It goes together.
Remember, we have to define all these. So
yeah.
That's all you want.
We
have
to
agree
to this.
How big is the budget
document?
We're not going to be able to fit one of those little
pictures.
Yeah, I think that's good.
So, C is topics upcoming. I think given the, if you don't mind, Jody, given the March meeting is going to be around MEPRI now, which is going to be the heavy focus, I think we could almost stay with the same agenda.
It's the second meeting.
And the same listing.
I think we'll have one more meeting before then.
We have two.
two more meetings before that, really, right?
We have another one.
Where are we?
No.
I
thought we were only going to have it starting in March.
No, we're scheduled for two per month.
I have one on February 25th.
Yeah, so that's at the end of February.
And then there's another one in early March before the 24th.
February
20th,
yeah, March 10th, February
24th. Before this report is in front of us.
Yeah.
Again, because they're scheduled doesn't mean we need to have them necessarily.
Right. We could always skip that, the last one in February, and go to, you know, starting, I feel like it's starting in March, things are going to start to pick up.
Sure.
And so then maybe that first meeting in March.
Do you have the date right there?
March, yeah, March 10th.
So are we canceling the, not canceling, just not having the February 25th meeting?
I'm just trying
I'm
to...
Okay, I'm okay with that. I don't have a problem with that. I want to make sure I take it off my calendar if that's the case.
So I'm okay with either way. I was going to recommend that if anything, you could take up as the only item. There's been a discussion on the town side in the town finance committee regarding capital improvement projects and capital expenditures and how they're funded over time. And if... because we're looking at a capital policy, at least for the town side, and how that might apply across the board for everyone. And so there was a request that we might take a look at it as a research exercise, not really as an initiative to mandate for the coming year. If we take that policy and look at the school's budget and the town's budget, what would have been excluded from the funding, the capital debt, and put into what would have been the impact of the operating budget? So that might be a good exercise for the 20th, leave that as the sole item for the 25th.
We also discussed possibly fund balance discussions as well.
That would be a good discussion for, I forgot about that, yeah. If that's okay with Jody and...
Do you want to do it in the February 24th? You're saying that...
February 25th, and
25th,
then...
25th, I'm sorry.
And then we still have March 10th, too.
I'm going to say I'm not here on the 25th, so that's, if it's fund balance or the capital one, then...
Well, but obviously those two would have to then change the March. Would you be available for us to?
Yeah, one way we could advance that operational capital budget discussion is George and I and Kate and Ruth can put our heads together and come up with tangible examples, things that are typically funded through capital that look, feel, and really ought to be in operations, just so you can appreciate the magnitude and what impact that has. These are big numbers to be shifted over to the operational side. I don't know if that's an effective way of helping define the conversation or guide the conversation, I should say.
I think so.
Yeah. I was going to suggest simply taking this year's budget.
Take our capital budget for this year.
Take the budget that we currently have and say that if we apply this, what would have happened if we could go back in time and we had this policy, what would the budget have looked like at the beginning of the decision process?
Tried to do that, you might recall,
yeah.
And it ended up being not that simple an exercise. It's
right.
The only reason I'm suggesting that
I think it's
simple.
It ends up being a little, we went over that in finance a little bit. It strikes me that it ends up being, I don't want to say subjective, because it is sort of subjective, but it's not. It's a question of, you know, do we, you know, like the carpet, I think was an example that you gave, you know, is it better to fund it all at once or spread it out over 3 years at smaller amounts or, I mean, I think I don't know how we, trying to wrap my hands around how we get a policy that you just plug and play and it just comes in one and spits out data about the back end unless we just did it purely based on value. But I think that sells us a little short with flexibility of how we deal with different forms of debt.
And then those items that do come into should be operational, all of a sudden you only have it once every 4 years. So year one, you have this huge number, and two, three, and four, and then five, it goes back up again, and then everybody gets up and out.
It makes
a huge
increase.
Or we could do, as you had mentioned, I think the last finance meeting, would we look at a policy, depending on the values we're talking about, of, you know, putting a placeholder every year in the budget for, let's say, it's a $20,000 vehicle, $5,000 a year for 4 years, knowing that in the fifth year we're going to purchase that out. But then it moves out of capital into operation. But it's going to potentially be a pretty complex discussion. I don't know.
But either approach is hypothetical.
That's true.
It's the same conversation.
It is.
Just what data set are you going to use for the conversation?
right?
I was just suggesting, I can think of two things on the town side and two things on the school side that everyone can relate to, and you can have a real life conversation, not theoretical. We do this stuff every year, it's a big ticket item. You could argue that it could be financed, but because we do it every year, shouldn't we build it in structurally to the budget? You know, a tech refresh, some number toward technology investment
mm-hmm.
every year.
$7.5 million.
Buying a bus or two or three every year.
Right.
We buy plow trucks every year.
We
do,
try putting buses into operations and have them in there for
I think if we talk about tangible projects that we can all relate to, it might be a good way of backing into this conversation. If we could move those four items or figure that out, it would be a success to me in this budget year.
Because I don't think this is going to be a one-year thing. I think this is going to be an over number of years, especially if we want to bring, if we buy two plow trucks every year or two buses, chances are we don't want to bring both, all four of those in 1 year into
right.
the operating.
You
so, you know,
them.
Even if we do half and half, you know, a quarter of the thing
yeah.
this year and a quarter the next quarter.
Is there a policy draft at this point?
Yes.
I was going to say,
it came our way a long time ago.
Yeah, I can send
it. The Finance Committee decided not to forward it to the full council yet, so we wanted to use this as the test case here to see what the impact of the policy would be. And for me, I'm not looking at buses and plows. I'm looking at the smaller ticket items that are constantly replaced. Yeah, because I mean, I think the common person in Scarborough is going to sit there and say, they can understand why you're financing a plow or financing whatever it might be. I really do believe that's logical. It's why are you financing new carpet? You know, is it because of the dollar? I mean, it's not explained. So it's the smaller pieces. Or why are you? I mean, some of the I don't agree with it, but some of the comments last year were, you know, why do you have in your funding package technology cords? You know, replacement cords. You know, that was something small because normally you would just go and buy it, and that's what they kind of related to. So I'm looking at the smaller pieces. I'm not looking at the big ticket.
Well, the problem was our policy had a threshold of $100,000.
I know.
And frequency.
I didn't agree with that. Right.
I don't think we got the policy right, and that's why
I
kind of the break up.
So to your point, Tom, it seems as though the 25th is going to not be happening as a larger meeting. Maybe you and Kate and Ruth and me can sit, and we can begin to at least organize.
I'm not for that day.
Well, somewhere around that day.
Yeah.
I'm just trying to put it into a time period that we already have.
So for us, we're all in agreement we're going to cancel the 25th, that we do not need to have a meeting?
Sure. We don't need the 25th, so we'll reconvene on March 10th.
March 10th,
and
the 10th is going to be?
Is that conversation that we just,
But again.
We'll have it again. We'll be more organized about it.
Right.
With numbers.
Just one quick thing. Has someone reserved the auditorium for the budget forum? Okay. So we can talk about those details. I just want to make sure
we've
checked
out
space.
A number of levels.
Is that on our agenda for the future? Because we should probably start working on the details.
Budget forum details are
What we did last year, I think, that worked was some of us kind of did that outside of this meeting.
Yeah.
And having done it once, it would seem it would be even easier to do it this year.
So I think, Chris, you and I sat with the two managers and really drove the organization around that, the timeline, and it wasn't really, we came back and reported it rather than having a group discussion. So we can do that again. That needs to be in March, though, I will say.
That's what I said. You and Jimmy can do it. I get the day off.
I didn't hear that.
So if we can come up with a date, the four of us can meet in March, to talk about the budget. Because at the very least, on the 24th, we can hand out something and say, here's the outline.
Okay.
Because I'm sure a CPR, or whatever it is, is going to be a very lengthy conversation, but if we at least have a handout on the budget forum. Okay.
We could just give you a couple of suggestions.
Great.
Excellent.
The one item we added to the agenda is supposed to be a standing item. We're not taking minutes necessarily at these meetings, we're taping them, but is maybe a quick recap around the table. And in particular, for those school board and town council members you know, what's important that you might want to report back out to your respective bodies or to the public, or whatever we learned in the meeting, whatever, however you like to handle it.
I think the big one for all of us, or for Sean and I, will be to invite Sean, invite the town council, I'll invite the school board to the March 24th meeting here.
10th and the 24th at 2 p.m.?
2 p.m.
We can talk about logistics, how we set this room up, so it's comfortable and convenient for the presenters and for all the rest. I don't think this setup will work.
Just in recapping, we've decided to wait and just have that metrics conversation continue, but have that be informed basically by the Research Institute report that we get on the 24th.
Mm-hmm.
And there's going to be both a Word doc and Google doc a glossary of terms that we will all have access to and begin some plugging some things in. There's actually an education website that you can go on, and I bet that they would give us some pretty decent definitions for the ones that are mostly education. And and I think Jody was going to do that.
Mm-hmm. Jake might have some for the
Wikipedia
child evaluation.
A tremendous resource.
Can you get that in a Word doc?
In addition, so I have the invite on the 24th on my list. We'll also, just so that everyone knows that the chairs and the staff will have a March meeting. March meeting for budget. The budget forum. To start the guideline, and the goal was to then report out, at least in a handout, on 3/24. The metrics are dependent on the 3/24 discussion, but I think I'm going to stress that its metrics are really school-related, educationally related, and the town council's finance committee really needs to delve into what are going to be appropriate measures for our side so that we can have a joint message out. And then March 10th meeting is regularly scheduled, and we're going to talk about fund balance and capital budgets, capital expenditures and budgets.
I'll try and get the capital policy out,
yep,
if you'd like, to everybody.
Oh, that'd be great.
And then the draft one, not final.
And are we tasking ourselves with providing definitions to the...
Yeah.
Are you going to work on
those
out?
So, I'll type them all up. I'll send them out, however they need to be sent out to everybody, and then just send them back to me.
Who's going to do the definitions?
Well, the school board will do the school... and you guys can determine
I like that too, because they're off school.
Level services, I wonder whether or not it's a different definition based on the budget.
That would be helpful.
Assigning.
All defining the same thing.
Right. Yeah.
Do you expect other Board of Education members would be interested enough in attending the September 24th? Obviously, this
March
report, 24th. March 24th, it's going to be a very informative report.
Mm-hmm.
I was just thinking of at least advising the other town council members just in case they had the opportunity.
That's good. Yeah, he's doing it.
We both have it on our list.
Yeah, good. I guess then the next question is, I assume we're going to put that report in our collective document setting, correct?
Be the first thing we upload.
Yeah.
Yep. We're ready to go. It's there waiting to receive information.
But not before we have the presentation.
No. I don't know that, it's ready to roll.
We can put these things up there. We can put anything we want.
Yeah, I guess. Should I put these minutes? Are that minutes with agendas?
Start posting agendas.
No.
Okay.
That's right. Yeah.
So there'd just be one other meeting that would be us and Ruth and Kate.
Right.
To begin to organize around the capital versus operational.
Operational.
And,
you'll have to send the invitation by mail. With nice stationery.
There's some really nice stamps right now.
And I'm trying to get rid of the letter and policy.
We can't afford it on the town side.
You question me, we're going to go there.
That remains to be proven, actually.
Yeah.
Oh.
So in your analysis and conversation that you four have around the capital improvements piece, so no matter what data set you use, it's a, in a way it's a hypothetical conversation or it's a theoretical conversation. What I would like to see or at least understand is, in the end, what is the net impact to the tax rate consideration when you're talking about it? Because you can throw numbers out there. That's why it was important. I said I wanted to at least take the current budget. What would happen on an annualized basis if we started moving stuff out of long-term debt and putting it into the operating budget? What does that do? Because when we set goals of no more than 3%, at least 3%, whatever, I can't remember the exact terminology, you're taking chunks away when you're starting having these auxiliary policies. So I think that's important to understand.
Very important.
Mm-hmm. It's really important.
Yeah, for those that, yeah, we can quantify what the impact is.
Okay, that's what I
and then we'll take that up in the next meeting after that.
Yeah, I just want to make sure. Okay. Great. Motion to adjourn? Well, it's a workshop. We're adjourned.
Can you just knock on that door?
I know.